Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Palace Walk by Naguib Mahfouz, translated by William Maynard Hutchins and Olive E. Kenny, narrated by Neil Shah. 1. She woke at midnight. She always woke up then, without having to rely on an alarm clock. A wish that had taken root in her awoke her with great accuracy. For a few moments she was not sure she was awake. Images from her dreams and perceptions mixed together in her mind. She was troubled by anxiety before opening her eyes, afraid sleep had deceived her. Shaking her head gently, she gazed at the total darkness of the room. There was no clue by which to judge the time. The street noise outside her room would continue until dawn. She could hear the babble of voices from the coffee houses and bars, whether it was early evening, midnight, or just before daybreak. She had no evidence to rely on except her intuition, like a conscious clock hand, and the silence encompassing the house, which revealed that her husband had not yet rapped at the door, and that the tip of his stick had not yet struck against the steps of the staircase. Habit woke her at this hour. It was an old habit she had developed when young, and it had stayed with her as she matured. She had learned it along with the other rules of married life. She woke up at midnight to await her husband's return from his evening's entertainment. Then she would serve him until he went to sleep. She sat up in bed resolutely to overcome the temptation posed by sleep. After invoking the name of God, she slipped out from under the covers and onto the floor. Groping her way to the door, she guided herself by the bedpost and a panel of the window. As she opened the door, faint rays of light filtered in from a lamp set on a bracketed shelf in the sitting room. She went to fetch it, and the glass projected onto the ceiling a trembling circle of pale light hemmed in by darkness. She placed the lamp on the table by the sofa. The light shone throughout the room, revealing the large, square floor, high walls, and ceiling with parallel beams. The quality of the furnishings was evident. The Shiraz carpet, large brass bed, massive armoire, and long sofa draped with a small rug in a patchwork design of different motifs and colors. The woman headed for the mirror to look at herself. She noted that her brown scarf was wrinkled and pushed back. Strands of chestnut hair had crept down over her forehead. Grasping the knot with her fingers, she untied it. She smoothed the scarf around her hair and retied the two ends slowly and carefully. She wiped the sides of her face with her hands, as though trying to erase any last vestiges of sleep. In her 40s, and of medium build, she looked slender, although her body's soft skin was filled out to its narrow limits in a charmingly harmonious and symmetrical way. Her face was oblong, with a high forehead and delicate features. She had beautiful small eyes with a sweet, dreamy look. Her nose was petite and thin, flaring out a little at the nostrils. Beneath her tender lips, a tapered chin descended. The pure, fair skin of her cheek revealed a beauty spot of intensely pure black. She seemed to be in a hurry as she wrapped her veil about her and headed for the door to the balcony. Opening it, she entered the closed cage formed by the wooden latticework and stood there, turning her face right and left while she peeked out through the tiny round openings of the latticework panels that protected her from being seen from the street. The balcony overlooked the ancient building housing a cistern downstairs and a school upstairs, which was situated in the middle of Palace Walk, or Bain El Kasrain. Two roads met there, in Nahassin, or Coppersmith Street, going south, and Palace Walk, which went north. To her left, the street appeared narrow and twisting. It was enveloped in a gloom that was thicker overhead, where the windows of the sleeping houses looked down, and less noticeable at street level, because of the light coming from the handcarts and from the vapor lamps of the coffee houses and the shops that stayed open until dawn. To her right, the street was engulfed in darkness. There were no coffee houses in that direction, only large stores, which closed early. There was nothing to attract the eye except the minarets of the ancient seminaries of Kalaun and Barkuk, which loomed up like ghostly giants, enjoying a night out by the light of the gleaming stars. It was a view that had grown on her over a quarter of a century. She never tired of it. Perhaps boredom was an irrelevant concept for a life as monotonous as hers. The view had been a companion for her in her solitude, and a friend in her loneliness during a long period when she was deprived of friends and companions before her children were born, when for most of the day and night she had been the sole occupant of this large house with its two stories of spacious rooms with high ceilings, its dusty courtyard, and deep well. She had married before she turned 14, and had soon found herself the mistress of the big house, following the deaths of her husband's parents. An elderly woman had assisted her in looking after it, but deserted her at dusk to sleep in the oven room in the courtyard, leaving her alone in a nocturnal world teeming with spirits and ghosts. She would doze for an hour and lie awake the next, until her redoubtable husband returned from a long night out. To set her mind at rest, she had gotten into the habit of going from room to room, accompanied by her maid, who held the lamp for her, while she cast searching, frightened glances through the rooms, one after the other. She began with the first floor, and continued with the upper story, reciting the Quran surahs she knew, in order to ward off demons. She would conclude with her room, lock the door, and get into bed. But her recitations would continue until she fell asleep. She had been terrified of the night when she first lived in this house. She knew far more about the world of the jinn than that of mankind, and remained convinced that she was not alone in the big house. There were demons who could not be lured away from these spacious, empty old rooms for long. Perhaps they had sought refuge there before she herself had been brought to the house, even before she saw the light of day. She frequently heard their whispers. Time and again she was awakened by their warm breath. When she was left alone, her only defense was reciting the opening prayer of the Quran and Surah 112 from it, about the absolute supremacy of God, or rushing to the latticework screen at the window to peer anxiously through it at the lights of the carts and the coffee houses, listening carefully for a laugh or cough to help her regain her composure. Then the children arrived, one after the other. In their early days in the world, though, they were tender sprouts, unable to dispel her fears or reassure her. On the contrary, her fears were multiplied by her troubled soul's concern for them, and her anxiety that they might be harmed. She would hold them tight, lavish affection on them, and surround them, whether awake or asleep, with a protective shield of Quran surahs, amulets, charms, and incantations. True peace of mind she would not achieve until her husband returned from his evening's entertainment. It was not uncommon for her, while she was alone with an infant, rocking him to sleep and cuddling him, to clasp him to her breast suddenly. She would listen intently with dread and alarm, and then call out in a loud voice, as though addressing someone in the room,
"Leave us alone. This isn't where you belong. We are Muslims and believe in the one God."
Then she would quickly and fervently recite the 112th surah of the Quran about the uniqueness of God. Over the course of time, as she gained more experience living with the spirits, her fears diminished a good deal. She was calm enough to jest with them without being frightened. If she happened to sense one of them prowling about, she would say in an almost intimate tone,
"Have you no respect for those who worship God, the Merciful? He will protect us from you, so do us the favor of going away."
But her mind was never completely at rest until her husband returned. Indeed, the mere fact of his presence in the house, whether awake or asleep was enough to make her feel secure. Then it did not matter whether the doors were open or locked, the lamp burning brightly or extinguished. It had occurred to her once, during the first year she lived with him, to venture a polite objection to his repeated nights out. His response had been to seize her by the ears and tell her peremptorily, in a loud voice,
"I'm a man. I'm the one who commands and forbids. I will not accept any criticism of my behavior. All I ask of you is to obey me. Don't force me to discipline you."
She learned from this, and from the other lessons that followed, to adapt to everything, even living with the jinn, in order to escape the glare of his wrathful eye. It was her duty to obey him without reservation or condition. She yielded so wholeheartedly that she even disliked blaming him privately for his nights out. She became convinced that true manliness, tyranny, and staying out till after midnight were common characteristics of a single entity. With the passage of time, she grew proud of whatever he meted out, whether it pleased or saddened her. No matter what happened, she remained a loving, obedient, and docile wife. She had no regrets at all about reconciling herself to a type of security based on surrender. Whenever she thought back over her life, only goodness and happiness came to mind. Fears and sorrows seemed meaningless ghosts to her, worth nothing more than a smile of pity. Had she not lived with this husband and his shortcomings for a quarter century, and been rewarded by children who were the apples of her eye, a home amply provided with comforts and blessings, and a happy adult life? Of course she had. Being surrounded by the jinn had been bearable, just as each evening was bearable. None of them had attempted to hurt her or the children. They had only played some harmless pranks to tease her. Praise God, the merit was all God's. He calmed her heart, and with his mercy brought order to her life. She even profoundly loved this hour of waiting up, though it interrupted a pleasant sleep and forced her to do chores that should have ceased with the end of the day. Not only had it become an integral part of her life, tied to many of her memories, but it continued to be the living symbol of her affection for her spouse, of her wholehearted dedication to making him happy, which she revealed to him night after night. For this reason, she was filled with contentment as she stood in the balcony peering through the openings toward Palace Walk and El Khurunfush streets, and then toward Hammam El Sultan, or the various minarets. She let her eyes wander over the houses bunched together untidily on both sides of the road, like a row of soldiers standing at ease, relaxing from harsh discipline. She smiled at the beloved view of this road, which stayed awake until the break of dawn, while the other streets, lanes, and alleys slept. It distracted her from her sleeplessness and kept her company when she was lonely, dispelling her fears. Night changed nothing save to envelop the surrounding areas with a profound silence that provided a setting in which the street sounds could ring out clearly, like the shadows at the edges of a painting that give the work depth and clarity. A laugh would resound as though bursting out in her room, and a remark made in a normal tone of voice could be heard distinctly. She could listen to a cough rattle on until it ended in a kind of moan. A waiter's voice would ring out like the call of a muezzin.
"Another ball of tobacco for the pipe!"
And she would merrily ask herself,
"By God, are these people ordering a refill at this hour?"
They reminded her of her absent husband. She would wonder,
"Where do you suppose he is now? What is he doing? May he be safe and sound, whatever he does."
It was suggested to her once that a man like Mr. Ahmed Abdul Jawad, so wealthy, strong, and handsome, who stayed out night after night, must have other women in his life. At that time, her life was poisoned by jealousy, and intense sorrow overcame her. Her courage was not up to speaking to him about it, but she confided her grief to her mother, who sought as best she could to soothe her mind with fine words, telling her,
"He married you after divorcing his first wife. He could have kept her too, if he'd wanted, or taken second, third, or fourth wives. His father had many wives. Thank our Lord that you remain his only wife."
Although her mother's words did not help much then, she eventually accepted their truth and validity. Even if the rumor was accurate, perhaps that was another characteristic of manliness, like late nights and tyranny. At any rate, a single evil was better than many. It would be a mistake to allow suspicion to wreck her good life filled with happiness and comfort. Moreover, in spite of everything, perhaps the rumor was idle speculation or a lie. She discovered that jealousy was no different from the other difficulties troubling her life. To accept them was an inevitable and binding decree. Her only means of combating them was, she found, to call on patience and rely on her inner strength, the one resource in the struggle against disagreeable things. Jealousy and its motivation became something she put up with, like her husband's other troubling characteristics, or living with the jinn. She continued to watch the road and listen to the people chat until she heard a horse's hoofbeats. She turned her head toward En-Nahassin Street and saw a carriage slowly approaching, its lamp shining in the darkness. She sighed with relief and murmured, "Finally." It was the carriage of one of his friends, bringing him to the door of his house after their evening out, before continuing on as usual to Al-Khurunfush with the owner and some other friends who lived there. The carriage stopped in front of the house, and her husband's voice rang out cheerfully,
"May God keep you!"
She would listen lovingly and with amazement to her husband's voice when he said good night to his friends. If she had not heard him every night at about this hour, she would not have believed it. She and the children were accustomed to nothing but prudence, dignity, and gravity from him. How did he come by these joyful, jesting sounds, which flowed out so merrily and graciously? The owner of the carriage teased her husband, asking,
"Did you hear what the horse said to himself when you got out? He commented, 'It's a pity I bring a man like you home every night when all you deserve is an ass.'"
The men in the vehicle exploded with laughter. Her husband waited for them to quiet down. Then he replied,
"Didn't you hear the answer? He said in that case, I'd be riding you."
The men burst out laughing once more. The vehicle's owner said,
"We'll have to rest for tomorrow night."
The carriage proceeded along Palace Walk, and her husband headed for the door. She left the balcony for the bedroom. Picking up the lamp, she went to the sitting room, and then to the hall to stand at the top of the stairs. She could hear the outside door being slammed shut, and the bolt sliding into place. She imagined his tall figure crossing the courtyard as he donned awesome dignity and shed the mirthfulness which, had she not overheard it, she would have never thought possible. Hearing the tip of his walking stick strike the steps of the stairway, she held the lamp out over the banister to light his way. 2. The man made his way toward her. She went on ahead of him, holding the lamp aloft. He followed, mumbling,
"Good evening, Amina."
She replied in a low voice, both polite and deferential,
"Good evening, sir."
When they reached the bedroom, Amina went to put the lamp on the table, while her husband hung his stick on the edge of the bedstead. He took off his fez, which he placed on the cushion at the center of the sofa, and then his wife approached to help him remove his clothes. He looked tall and broad-shouldered standing there. He had a massive body with a large, firm belly, covered smartly and comfortably by a cloak and a kaftan that showed both his good taste and his wealth. His spread of neatly combed and parted black hair, his ring with its large diamond and his gold watch only served to emphasize his refinement and affluence. His long face was expressive, with firm skin and clean-cut features. Taken as a whole, it revealed his strong personality and good looks. He had wide blue eyes and a large, proud nose which, despite its size, was well proportioned for the expanse of his face. His lips were full, and the ends of his thick black mustache were twisted with extraordinary care. When his wife came near him, he spread his arms out. She removed his cloak and folded it carefully before placing it on the sofa. Turning back to him, she loosened the sash of his caftan, removed it, and folded it up with similar care to lay it on top of the cloak. Her husband took his house shirt and then his white skullcap, putting on each in turn. Yawning, he stretched and sat down on the sofa. He spread out his legs and leaned his head against the wall. After his wife finished arranging his clothes, she sat beside his extended feet and began to remove his shoes and socks. When his right foot was bared, the first defect of this handsome, powerful body was revealed. His little toe had been eaten away by successive scrapings of a razor attacking a chronic corn. Amina left the room for a few minutes and returned with a basin and pitcher. Placing the basin by her husband's feet, she stood ready and waiting with the pitcher in her hand. Her husband straightened up and held his hands out to her. She poured the water for him. He washed his face, rubbed his head, and rinsed thoroughly. Then he took the towel from the sofa cushion and set about drying his head, face, and hands, while his wife carried the basin to the bath. This task was the last of many duties she performed in the big house. For a quarter of a century, she had continued to discharge it with an ardor undimmed by ennui. To the contrary, she did it with pleasure and delight, and with the same enthusiasm that spurred her on to undertake the other household chores from just before sunrise until sunset. For this reason, she was called the Bee by women in her neighborhood, in recognition of her incessant perseverance and energy. She returned to the room, closed the door, and pulled a pallet out from under the bed. She placed it in front of the sofa and sat cross-legged on it. In good conscience, she did not think she had any right to sit beside him. Time passed without her speaking. She waited until he invited her to speak. Then she would. Her husband slumped back against the sofa cushion. After a long evening of partying, he looked tired. His eyelids, which were red at the edges from his drinking, drooped. He was breathing heavily, as if inebriated. Although he was in the habit of drinking to the point of intoxication every night, he postponed his return home until the effects of the wine had worn off and he had regained control of himself. He wished to protect his dignity and image at home. His wife was the only member of his family allowed to see him after he had been out carousing. The only effect of the drinking she could remark was the smell. She had never encountered any alarming or perverse conduct from him, except when they were first married, and she had chosen to overlook that. Paradoxically, by keeping him company at this hour, she reaped a chattiness and expansiveness in his conversation she could rarely gain when he was completely sober. She well remembered how distressed she had been when she first noticed he was coming home drunk from his evening escapades. To her mind, wine had always suggested brutality and craziness and, most shocking of all, an offense against religion. She had been disgusted and scared. Whenever he came home, she had suffered unbearable torments. In time, experience had revealed that on his return from his partying, he was more gentle than on any other occasion, and not so stern. His look was more tender, and he was much more talkative. She grew to enjoy his company, and stopped worrying, although she never forgot to implore God to pardon his sin and forgive him. She dearly wished he would be that good-humored when he was sober and in his right mind. She was thoroughly amazed that this sin made him more amiable. She was torn for a long time between her hatred for it, based on her religious training, and the comfort and peace she gained from it. She buried her thoughts deep inside her, however, and concealed them, as though unable even to admit them to herself. Her husband spared no effort to safeguard his dignity and authority. His moments of tenderness were fleeting and accidental. As he sat there, a broad smile might appear on his lips at a memory that cropped up from his happy evening. At once he would get control of himself and press his lips together while stealing a glance at his wife. He would find her as usual, in front of him, with her eyes lowered. Reassured, he would return to his memories and his heart that cherished them as though from an unquenchable thirst for the pleasures of life. It seemed he could still see the party, composed of a select group of his favorite friends and chums. In the midst of them was one of those moon-like beauties who shone in his life from time to time. He could still hear the jokes, wisecracks, and witty comments for which he had such a talent, stringing one after the other when he was animated by wine and music. He recalled his clever remarks with a care and attention accented by wonder and self-satisfaction. He remembered their effect on people, and the success and delight they occasioned, making him everyone's best friend. It was hardly surprising. He often felt the role he played at these parties was so significant that it was practically the ultimate anyone could hope for in life. His career as a whole was a necessary task he performed in order to gain some hours filled with drink, laughter, song, and flirtation to be spent in the chummy company of his pals. Now and then some of the sweet, catchy tunes that were sung at their happy parties ran through his head. He abandoned himself to them and sighed as they drifted away from him.
God is most great.
He loved the singing as much as the drink, laughter, companions, and pretty girls. He would not tolerate a party without song. It was nothing for him to journey a long way to the outskirts of Cairo in order to hear a renowned male vocalist like El Hamouli, Muhammad Uthman, or El Menyelawi, wherever he resided. Thus their tunes found shelter in his hospitable soul, like nightingales in a leafy tree. He became a music expert and an acknowledged authority on lyrics, tunes, and music appreciation. He loved song with both his soul and his body. Spiritually, he was transported and overwhelmed. Physically, his senses were strongly aroused, setting him dancing, particularly his head and hands. For this reason, he had unforgettable spiritual and physical associations with lines from songs like, "So why do you torment me and shun me?" or "What will we know tomorrow? What will we see the following day?" and "Listen then, and pay attention to what I'm telling you." Any one of these tunes, with its associated family of memories, would suffice to bring his intoxication to a boil. Transported by the music, he would nod his head, smile lasciviously, snap his fingers, and sing along when alone. Singing, however, was not an isolated pleasure attracting him for itself. It was a flower in a bouquet, gaining beauty from the setting and contributing to it. How welcome it was in the company of a close friend and loyal comrade when combined with vintage wine and pleasant conversation. To devote himself to it alone, to listen to it at home played on a phonograph, however fine and agreeable that might be, lacked the appropriate atmosphere, ambiance, and environment. How preposterous to think his heart should be satisfied with that. What he liked was to interpose a witty remark between one tune and the next to set everyone laughing, to take a sip from a full glass before starting the music again, and to observe its effects in the face of a friend or in the eye of a chum. Then they would all join in expressing their admiration by saying, "Praise the Lord." The creation of memories was not the only result of his partying. Another of its virtues was the tendency it produced in him to be kind to his obedient, submissive wife. It was what she longed for when she was with him. He was companionable and talkative. He would tell her his innermost thoughts, thus making her feel, if only for the moment, that she was not just his servant, but also a partner in his life. He proceeded to discuss household matters with her. He told her he had directed a merchant he knew to buy up a reserve of clarified butter, wheat, and cheese for the house. He attacked the rise in prices and the scarcity of necessary commodities caused by this war, which had been giving the world a pounding for the past 3 years. As always, when he mentioned the war, he began cursing the Australian troops who had spread through the city like locusts, destroying the land. The truth was, that he had a special reason for resenting the Australians. Their tyranny separated him from the Azbekia Garden Entertainment District, which he had abandoned in defeat, except for the few rare opportunities he could snatch. He could not stand to expose himself to soldiers who openly plundered people of their possessions and took pleasure in abusing and insulting them without restraint. He began to ask after the children, as he called them, making no distinction between the eldest of them, a clerk in En-Nehessin School, and the youngest, who was a pupil in Khalil Agha Elementary School. Then he inquired suspiciously,
"And Kemal? You better not be covering up his mischief."
The woman thought of her young son, whose innocent prank she did in fact conceal. Her husband did not recognize that there could be innocent games or amusements. She replied meekly,
"He respects his father's commands."
Her husband was silent for a moment. His thoughts seemed to be wandering. Once more, he was harvesting memories from his happy evening. Then his memory slipped back to the events of the day before the party. He remembered all at once that it had been a momentous day. In his condition, he did not feel like keeping from her anything that floated to consciousness. He said, as though addressing himself,
"What a fine man Prince Kemal el-Din Hussein is. Do you know what he did? He refused to ascend the throne of his late father so long as the British are in charge."
The woman had heard the day before of the death of Sultan Hussein Kemal, but this was the first time she heard the name of his son. She could not find anything to say, but moved by her feelings of veneration for the speaker, and afraid not to comment on something he said, she responded,
"May God have mercy on the Sultan and bless his son."
Her husband continued his remarks,
"Prince Ahmed Fuad, or Sultan Fuad, as he will be known from now on, accepted the throne. The celebration came to a climax today with his investiture. Then he went in a procession from Bustan Castle to Abdin Palace. Praise to God, the Everlasting."
Amina listened to him with interest and delight. She was interested in any news of the outside world, about which she knew almost nothing. Her delight was inspired by the affectionate attention she could boast of, because her husband had spoken to her of such weighty matters. Moreover, the knowledge represented by the conversation gave her pleasure, because she could repeat it to her children, especially her two daughters, who were as totally ignorant of the outside world as she. She could think of nothing better to repay him for his generous sentiments than to repeat in his hearing the prayer she knew he heartily endorsed. She was also expressing her own sincere emotions when she said,
"Our Lord can return our sovereign Abbas to us."
The man shook his head and murmured,
"When? When? Only the Lord knows. All we read about in the papers are British victories. Will they really win? Or will the Germans and Turks be victorious in the end? Answer our prayer, O God."
The man closed his eyes from fatigue and yawned. He stretched out, saying,
"Take the lamp back to the sitting room."
The woman got to her feet and took the lamp from the table. Before she left the room, she heard her husband belch. She stammered,
"Health and strength."
3. Through the stillness of the early morning, when the dark dawn sky was transfixed by arrows of light, there rose from the courtyard oven room the sound of dough being kneaded rhythmically, like the beating of a drum. Amina had been up for about half an hour. She had finished her ablutions and prayed before going down to the oven room to rouse Hanafi, the servant, who was in her 40s and had been a maid in the house when she was a girl. She had left the house to marry and had returned after her divorce. While Hanafi worked the dough, Amina busied herself preparing breakfast. The house had a wide courtyard with a well at the far right. The well's opening had been fitted with a wooden cover once children's feet began pattering across the ground. That was followed by the installation of water pipes. On the far left, By the entrance to the women's quarters were two large chambers. The oven occupied one, devoted to baking, and the other served as a storeroom. The oven room, although isolated, had a special claim on Amina's affections. If the hours she had passed inside it were added up, they would be a lifetime. Moreover, the room came alive with the delights of each holiday in its season, when hearts, merry with the joys of life, kept an anxious watch. Appetites were whetted by all the delicious foods prepared there for each holiday in turn, like the sweet fruit compotes and doughnuts for Ramadan, or the cake and pastries for Eid al-Fitr, marking the end of Ramadan. For Eid al-Adha, the Feast of the Sacrifice, there was a lamb that was fattened up and pampered, only to be slaughtered while the children watched. Thus, the universal rejoicing was not without a mournful tear. The blaze of the fire gleamed from the depths of the oven through the arched opening, like a flaming firebrand of joy in the secret recesses of the heart. It seemed both one of the ornaments of each festival and its harbinger. If Amina, in the upper stories, felt she was a deputy or representative of the ruler, lacking any authority of her own, here she was the queen, with no rival to her sovereignty. The oven lived and died at her command. The fate of the coal and wood, piled in the right-hand corner, rested on a word from her. The stove that occupied the opposite corner, beneath shelves with pots, plates, and the copper serving tray, slept or hissed with flame at a gesture from her. Here she was the mother, wife, teacher, and artist everyone respected. They had full confidence in everything she produced. The only praise she ever succeeded in eliciting from her husband, if he did favor her with praise, was for a type of food she prepared and cooked to perfection. Hanafi was the right arm of this small empire. Whether Amina directed the work herself, or allowed one of her daughters to practice this craft under her supervision. Hanafi was a stout woman who was shapeless and formless. The single goal governing her ample increase in flesh had been corpulence. Considerations of beauty had been ignored. She was totally satisfied, for she reckoned corpulence to be beauty of the finest sort. No wonder, then, that all her household chores seemed almost secondary to her in comparison with her primary duty, which was to fatten up the family, or more specifically, the females, with miraculous remedies that were not only charms to produce beauty, but its secret essence. Although these potions did not always do the trick, they had proved their value more than once, and deserved the hopes and dreams invested in them. It was not surprising that Hanafi should grow plump in these circumstances, but her weight in no way diminished her vigor. The moment her mistress woke her, she rose, ready to get to work. She hastened to the bread basin, and soon there rang out the sound of kneading, which served as an alarm clock in this house. It reached the children on the first floor, and the father on the top floor, notifying everyone that it was time to rise. Mr. Ahmed Abdeljawad rolled over on his side and opened his eyes. He scowled at once, furious at the sound that had disturbed his sleep. He suppressed his anger, however, since he knew he had to wake up. Normally, his first sensation after regaining consciousness was of his hangover. He struggled against it forcefully and sat up in bed, although still dominated by a desire to go back to sleep. His boisterous nights were not able to make him forget his daytime duties. He would awake at this early hour, no matter how late he had been in getting to bed, in order to leave for his shop a little before 8. During his siesta, he would have ample time to make up for his lost sleep and to restore his energy for another night on the town. Thus, the moment he awoke was the worst of his whole day. He would leave his bed, swaying from exhaustion and dizziness. He encountered a life devoid of any sweet memories or warm feelings. They seemed to have changed into a pounding in his brain and eyelids. The blows of the dough went on relentlessly. Fami was one of the earliest of those awakened on the first floor. He was easy to rouse, even though he stayed up late concentrating on his law books. The first image that came to him on waking was of a round face with black eyes at the center of its ivory surface. He whispered to himself,
"Mariam."
Had he yielded to the temptation, he would have remained under the covers for a long time to be alone with the phantom visitor who came to keep him company with the tenderest affection. He would gaze at her to his heart's content, converse with her, and reveal one secret after another to her, while drawing close to her, with a daring not imaginable, except in this warm repose early in the morning. As usual, however, he postponed this reverie until Friday morning and sat up in bed. He turned to look at his brother sleeping in the adjoining bed and shouted,
"Yassine! Yassine! Wake up!"
The youth's snoring was cut short. He snorted in annoyance and muttered rather nasally,
"I'm awake. I woke up before you."
Fahmy waited, smiling, till the other began snoring again. Then he yelled at him,
"Wake up!"
Grumbling, Yassine rolled over in bed. The cover slipped off one side of his body, which resembled his father's in size and bulk. He opened his bloodshot eyes, which gazed vacantly beneath a brow contracted in a disgruntled frown.
"Quay, how did it get to be morning so fast? Why can't we sleep till we've had enough? Discipline, always discipline. We might as well be in the army."
He reared up, supporting himself on his hands and knees. He shook his head to expel its drowsiness. He happened to look over at the third bed, where Kemal lay sleeping. No one would wrench him out of his sleep for half an hour. Yassine said enviously,
"The lucky kid."
As his head cleared a little, he sat up with his legs crossed under him on the bed. He rested his head in his hands. He wished it was filled with the sweet thoughts that brighten daydreams, but he, like his father, awoke with enough of a hangover to keep dreams at bay. He saw the musician Zanuba in his imagination, though not with his normal delight. All the same, his lips parted in a smile. In the adjoining room, Khadija had gotten out of bed without having to use the dough alarm. She, of all the family, most resembled her mother in energy and early rising. Aisha generally was awakened by the movement of the bed when her sister sat up and jumped to the floor. Khadija intentionally rocked the bed and thus started a quarrel and exchange of insults, which through repetition had become a coarse kind of joke. Although Aisha remained awake, she did not rise after she had stopped bickering, but surrendered to one of her long, happy daydreams. Life stirred and activity spread throughout the first floor. Windows were opened and light poured in. Close behind came a draft of air, bringing with it the grinding of the wheels of the mule-drawn Suarez omnibus, the voices of workmen, and the cry of the hot cereal vendor. Movement continued between the two bedrooms and the bath. Yassine appeared, his stocky body in a loose-fitting house shirt, along with Fahmy, who was tall and slim, resembling, except for this slenderness, his father. The two girls went down to the courtyard to join their mother in the oven room. Rarely will two such dissimilar people belong to one family. That Khadija was a brunette was not a flaw, but the features of her face were noticeably out of proportion with each other. Aisha, on the other hand, was a blonde, who radiated a halo of beauty and good looks. Although their father was alone on the top floor, Amina had arranged everything so he would need no assistance. On the table he found a cup filled with fenugreek tea, which he used to freshen his mouth. When he went to the bath, he inhaled the fragrance of sweet incense and found clean clothes carefully arranged on the chair. He washed in cold water, as he did every morning, summer or winter. Then he returned to his room with renewed vitality and energy. He took the prayer rug, which had been folded and placed on the back of the sofa, and spread it out to perform the morning prayer. When he prayed, his face was humble, not the smiling, merry face his friends encountered, or the stern, resolute one his family knew. This was a responsive face. Piety, love, and hope shone from its relaxed features, which were molded by a wish to ingratiate, cajole, and seek forgiveness. He did not pray in a mechanical way limited to recitation, standing, and prostration. His prayer was based on affection, emotion, and feelings. He performed it with the same enthusiasm he invested in every aspect of life, pouring himself into each. When he worked, he put his whole heart into it. If he befriended someone, he was exceptionally affectionate. When he fell in love, he was swept off his feet. He did not drink without getting drunk. He was earnest and sincere in everything. Thus, for him, the mandatory prayer became a spiritual pilgrimage in which he traversed the expansive realms of the Master. Even after he had finished praying, he would sit cross-legged with palms outstretched and implore God to watch over him carefully, forgive him, and bless his offspring and business. When the mother had finished preparing the food for breakfast, she allowed the girls to arrange it on the tray. She went to the brother's room, where she discovered Kemal still sound asleep. Smiling, she approached him and placed the palm of her hand on his forehead to recite the opening prayer of the Quran. Then she began calling him, shaking him gently. She did not leave him until he was out of bed. Fahmy came in. Seeing her there, he smiled and wished her good morning. She responded with a look of love sparkling in her eyes.
Light of my eyes, may your morning be bright.
She greeted her stepson, Yasin, with the same tenderness. He replied with the affection due a woman who was like a real mother to him. When Khadija returned from the oven room, Fahmy and Yasin, particularly Yasin, greeted her with some of the taunts they often used against her. Their jests were aimed at her disagreeable appearance or her sharp tongue. Nevertheless, she exerted considerable influence over the two brothers, since she looked after their concerns with an outstanding skill seldom volunteered by Aisha, who shone in the family as the beautiful but useless personification of good looks and charm. Yasin accosted Khadija.
We were talking about you. We were saying that if every woman looked like you, men would be spared all heartaches.
She shot back.
And if all men were like you, they would never get headaches from thinking.
At that, their mother called out,
Breakfast is ready, gentlemen.
4. The dining room was on the top floor, along with the parents' bedroom. On this story were also located a sitting room and a fourth chamber, which was empty, except for a few toys Kemal played with when he had time. The cloth had been spread on the low table and the cushions arranged around it. The head of the household came and sat down cross-legged in the principal place. The three brothers filed in. Yasin sat on his father's right, Fahmy at his left, and Kemal opposite him. The brothers took their places politely and deferentially, with their heads bowed as though at Friday prayers. There was no distinction in this between the secretary from En-Nehessin school, the law student, and the pupil from Khalil Agha. No one dared look directly at their father's face. When they were in his presence, they would not even look at each other, for fear of being overcome by a smile. The guilty party would expose himself to a dreadful scolding. Breakfast was the only time of day they were together with their father. When they came home in the afternoon, he would already have left for his shop after taking his lunch and a nap. He would not return again until after midnight. Sitting with him, even for such a short period, was extremely taxing for them. They were forced to observe military discipline all the time. Their fear itself made them more nervous and prone to the very errors they were trying so hard to avoid. The meal, moreover, was consumed in an atmosphere that kept them from relishing or enjoying the food. It was common for their father to inspect the boys during the short interval before the mother brought the tray of food. He examined them with a critical eye until he could discover some failing, however trivial, in a son's appearance or a spot on his clothes. Then a torrent of censure and abuse would pour forth. He might ask Kemal gruffly,
Have you washed your hands?
If Kamal answered in the affirmative, he would order him,
Show me.
Terrified, the boy would spread his palms out. Instead of commending him for cleanliness, the father would threaten him.
If you ever forget to wash them before eating, I'll cut them off to spare you the trouble of looking after them.
Sometimes he would ask Fahmy,
Is that son of a bitch studying his lessons or not?
Fahmy knew whom he meant, for son of a bitch was the epithet their father reserved for Kemal. Fahmy's answer was that Kemal memorized his lessons very well. The truth was that the boy had to be clever to escape his father's fury. His quick mind spared him the need to be serious and diligent, although his superior achievement implied he was both. The father demanded blind obedience from his sons, and that was hard to bear for a boy who loved playing more than eating. Remembering Kemal's playfulness, El Sayyid Ahmed commented angrily,
Manners are better than learning.
Then, turning toward Kemal, he continued sharply,
Hear that, you son of a bitch?
The mother carried in the large tray of food and placed it on the cloth. She withdrew to the side of the room near a table on which stood a water jug. She waited there, ready to obey any command. In the center of the gleaming copper tray was a large oval dish filled with fried beans and eggs. On one side, hot loaves of flat bread were piled. On the other side were arranged small plates with cheese, pickled lemons and peppers, as well as salt and cayenne and black pepper. The brothers' bellies were aflame with hunger, but they restrained themselves and pretended not to see the delightful array, as though it meant nothing to them, until their father put out his hand to take a piece of bread. He split it open while muttering,
Eat.
Their hands reached for the bread in order of seniority, Yasin, Fahmy, and then Kemal. They set about eating without forgetting their manners or reserve. Their father devoured his food quickly and in great quantities as though his jaws were a mechanical shredding device working non-stop at full speed. He lumped together into one giant mouthful a wide selection of the available dishes, beans, eggs, cheese, pepper, and lemon pickles, which he proceeded to pulverize with dispatch while his fingers prepared the next helping. His sons ate with deliberation and care, no matter what it cost them, and how incompatible it was with their fiery temperaments. They were painfully aware of the severe remark or harsh look they would receive should one of them be remiss or weak and forget himself, and thus neglect the obligatory patience and manners. Kemal was the most uneasy, because he feared his father the most. The worst punishment either of his two brothers would receive was a rebuke or a scolding. The least he could expect was a kick or a slap. For this reason, he consumed his food cautiously and nervously, stealing a glance from time to time at what was left. The food's quick disappearance added to his anxiety. He waited apprehensively for a sign that his father was finished eating. Then he would have a chance to fill his belly. Kemal knew that although his father devoured his food quickly, taking huge helpings selected from many different dishes, the ultimate threat to the food, and therefore to him, came from his two brothers. His father ate quickly and got full quickly. His two brothers only began the battle in earnest once their father left the table. They did not give up until the plates were empty of anything edible. Therefore, no sooner had his father risen and departed than Kemal rolled up his sleeves and attacked the food like a madman. He employed both his hands, one for the large dish and the other for the small ones. All the same, his endeavor seemed futile, given his brother's energetic efforts. So Kemal fell back on a trick he resorted to when his welfare was threatened in circumstances like these. He deliberately sneezed on the food. His two brothers recoiled, looking at him furiously, but left the table, convulsed with laughter. Kemal's dream for the morning was realized. He found himself alone at the table. The father returned to his room after washing his hands. Amina followed him there, bringing a cup containing 3 raw eggs mixed with a little milk, which she handed to him. After swallowing the concoction, he sat down to sip his morning coffee. The rich egg drink was the finale of his breakfast. It was one of a number of tonics he used regularly after meals or between them, like cod liver oil and sugared walnuts, almonds, and hazelnuts, to safeguard the health of his huge body. They helped compensate for the wear and tear occasioned by his passions. He also limited his diet to meat and varieties of foods known for their richness. Indeed, he scorned light and even normal meals as a waste of time not befitting a man of his stature. Hashish had been prescribed for him to stimulate his appetite in addition to its other benefits. Although he had tried it, he had never been comfortable with it and had abandoned it without regret. He disliked it because it induced in him a stupor, both somber and still, and a predisposition toward silence as well as a feeling of isolation, even when he was with his best friends. He disliked these symptoms that were in rude contrast to his normal disposition aflame with youthful outbursts of mirth, elated excitement, intimate delights, and bouts of jesting and laughter. For fear of losing the qualities required of an exceptionally virile lover, he dosed himself with an expensive narcotic for which Muhammad the Jami, the couscous vendor by the facade of the seminary of El Saleh Ayub in the vicinity of the Goldsmith's Bazaar, was renowned. The vendor prepared it as a special favor for his most honored clients among the merchants and the local notables. El Sayyid Ahmed was not addicted to the drugs, but he would take some from time to time, whenever he encountered a new love, particularly if the object of his passion was a woman experienced with men and their ways. He finished sipping his coffee. He got up to look in the mirror and began putting on the garments Amina handed to him one at a time. He cast a searching look at his attire. He combed his hair, which hung down on both sides of his head. Then he smoothed and twisted his mustache. He scrutinized the appearance of his face and turned slowly to the right to inspect the left side, and then to the left to study the right. When at last he was satisfied with what he saw, he stretched out his hand to his wife for the bottle of cologne Uncle Hassanain, the barber, prepared for him. He cleansed his hands and face and moistened the chest of his kaftan and his handkerchief with it. Then he put on his fez, took his walking stick, and left the room, spreading a pleasant fragrance before and after him. The whole family knew the scent, distilled from assorted flowers. Whenever they inhaled it, the image of the head of the house with his resolute, solemn face would come to mind. It would inspire in the heart, along with love, both awe and fear. At this hour of the morning, however, the fragrance was an announcement of their father's departure. Everyone greeted it with a relief that was innocent rather than reprehensible, like a prisoner's satisfaction on hearing the clatter of chains being unfastened from his hands and feet. Each knew he would shortly regain his liberty to talk, laugh, sing, and do many other things free from danger. Yasin and Fami had finished putting on their clothes. Kemal rushed to the father's room, immediately after he left, to satisfy a desire to imitate his father's gestures that he had stealthily observed from the edge of the door, which was ajar. He stood in front of the mirror looking at himself with care and pleasure. Then he barked in a commanding tone of voice to his mother.
The cologne, Amina.
He knew she would not honor this demand, but proceeded to wipe his hands on his face, jacket, and short pants, as if moistening them with cologne. Although his mother was struggling not to laugh, he zealously kept up the pretense of being in deadly earnest. He proceeded to review his face in the mirror from the right side to the left. He went on to smooth his imaginary mustache and twist its ends. After that, he turned away from the mirror and belched. He looked at his mother and, when he got no response from her except laughter, remonstrated with her,
"You're supposed to wish me health and strength."
The woman laughably mumbled,
"A health and strength, sir."
Then he left the room, mimicking his father's gait and holding his hands as though leaning on a stick. The mother and her two girls went at once to the balcony. They stood at the window overlooking En-Nahassin Street to observe through the holes of its wooden grille the men of the family on the street. The father could be seen moving in a slow and dignified fashion. He projected an aura of grandeur and good looks, raising his hands in greeting from time to time. Uncle Hassanain, the barber, Haj Darwish, who sold beans, El Fuli, the milkman, and El Bayumi, the drinks vendor, all rose to greet him. The women watched him with eyes filled with love and pride. Fami followed behind him with hasty steps, and then Yasin with the body of a bull and the elegance of a peacock. Finally, Kemal made his appearance. He had scarcely taken two steps when he turned around and looked up at the window, where he knew his mother and sisters were concealed. He smiled and then went on his way, clutching his book bag under his arm and searching the ground for a pebble to kick. This moment was one of the happiest of the mother's day. All the same, her anxiety that her men might be harmed by the evil eye knew no limits. She continued reciting the Quranic verse,
"And from the mischief of the envious person in his envy,"
Surah 113, verse 5, until they were out of sight. 5. The mother left the balcony, followed by Khadija, but Aisha tarried there till she was alone. Then she went to the side of the balcony overlooking Palace Walk. She peered out through the holes of the grill with interest and longing. The gleam in her eyes and the way she bit her lip showed she was expecting something to happen. She did not have to wait long, for a young police officer appeared from the corner of Al-Khurunfush Street. He came closer, slowly making his way toward the Gamaliya police station. At that, the girl quickly left the balcony for the sitting room and headed for the side window. She turned the knob and opened the two panels a crack. She stood there, her heart pounding with a violence provoked by both fear and affection. When the officer neared the house, he raised his eyes cautiously, but not his head, for in Egypt in those days it was not considered proper to raise your head in such circumstances. His face shone with the light of a hidden smile that was reflected on the girl's face as a shy radiance. She sighed and closed the window, fastening it nervously as though hiding evidence of a bloody crime. She retreated, her eyes closed from the intensity of the emotion. She let herself sink into a chair and leaned her head on her hand. She roamed through the space of her infinite sensations, experiencing neither sheer happiness or total fear. Her heart was divided between the two emotions, each mercilessly trying to attract it. If she succumbed to the intoxication and enchantment of happiness, fear's hammer struck her heart, warning and threatening her. She did not know whether it would be better for her to abandon her adventure or to continue obeying her heart. Her love and fear were both intense. She lingered in her drowsy conflict for some time. Then the voices of fear and censure subsided, and during this truce, she enjoyed an intoxicating dream. She recalled with her usual delight how she had been shaking dust from the window curtain one day when she chanced to look at the street through the window, which was halfway open to let the dust fly out. Her glance had fallen on him as he looked up at her face with astonished admiration. She had drawn back in apparent alarm, but before he disappeared from sight, he had made an unforgettable impression on her imagination with his gold star and red stripe. A vision to enchant the mind and ravish the imagination. It hovered before her eyes for a long time. At the same hour the next day, and for days after, she had gone to stand by the slit where he could not see her. She would observe with triumphant happiness how he looked up at the closed window with concern and longing, and then how his features were illumined by the light of joy as he began to discern her figure at the crack. Her heart, on fire and reaching out, awake for the first time, looked forward impatiently to this moment, savoring it happily, and then dreamily bidding it adieu as it ended. A month had passed, and once more it had been time to dust the curtains. She had set about shaking them, deliberately leaving the window halfway open so she could be seen. In this manner, days and months had passed, until her thirst for even more romance conquered her oppressive fear, and she had taken an insane step. She had opened the two panels of the window and stood there, her heart beating violently from affection and fear. She might as well have proclaimed her love to him. She seemed to be a person throwing herself down from a vast height to escape a searing fire all around her. The sentiments of fear and censure having subsided enough for a truce to be proclaimed, she enjoyed the intoxication of her dream. She awoke determined to shut out the fear troubling her serenity. In order to soothe her conscience, she started to tell herself,
"The earth didn't shake. Everything went off peacefully. No one saw me, and no one will. Moreover, I didn't do anything wrong."
She stood up and, to make herself think she had a clear conscience, sang in a sweet voice,
"You there with the red stripe, you who have taken me prisoner, have pity on my humiliation."
She sang it repeatedly until her sister Khadija's voice reached her from the dining room. Khadija shouted sarcastically,
"Diva Munira El Madia, you renowned prima donna, please do us the favor of eating. Your servant has set the table for you."
This voice brought her back to her senses, as though Khadija had shaken her. She fell from the platonic world of ideal forms to reality, feeling somewhat frightened for no clear reason, since everything had passed peacefully, as she told herself. All the same, her sister's voice, objecting to her singing and to her images in particular, alarmed her, possibly because Khadija was so critical toward her. Nevertheless, she set aside this momentary anxiety and responded with a brief laugh. She ran to the dining room and found that the cloth had indeed been spread, and that her mother was bringing in the tray of food. Khadija said to her sharply the moment she entered,
"You loll about, off by yourself, while I prepare everything. We've had enough singing."
Although Aisha usually spoke tenderly to Khadija to protect herself from Khadija's sharp tongue, the latter's insistence on reprimanding her whenever an opportunity arose occasionally made Aisha wish to rile her. Pretending to be in earnest, she said,
"Didn't we agree to divide the work in the house between us? So you do the chores, and I'll do the singing."
Khadija looked at her mother and said mockingly of her sister,
"Perhaps she intends to become a professional."
Aisha did not get angry. To the contrary, she said, again with affected seriousness,
"Why not? My voice is like a bird's, like a curlew's."
Although Aisha's previous words had not stirred Khadija's rage, since they were in jest, this last statement did, both because it was obviously true and because Khadija envied her the beauty of her voice along with her other attractions. So she attacked her.
"Listen, madam, this is the home of an honorable man. There would be nothing wrong with his daughters having voices like donkeys, but it's a disgrace for them to be nothing but pretty pictures of no use or value."
"If your voice were beautiful like mine, you wouldn't say that."
"Of course. We'd sing duets together. You'd say, 'You there with the red stripe, you who,' and I'd continue, 'Have taken me prisoner, have pity on my humiliation.' We'll let the lady,"
pointing toward her mother,
"do the sweeping, scrubbing, and cooking."
The mother, who was accustomed to this bickering, had taken her place and implored them,
"Trust in God. Sit down. Let's eat our breakfast in peace."
They came over and sat down. Khadija observed,
"Mother, you're not fit to raise anyone."
Her mother muttered calmly,
"God forgive you. I'll leave the child-rearing to you, so long as you don't forget your own manners."
She stretched her hand out to the tray of food, reciting,
"In the name of God, the merciful, the compassionate."
Khadija was 20, and the eldest, except for Yasin, her half-brother, who was about 21. She was strong and plump, thanks to Hanafi, although a trifle short. Her face had acquired its features from her parents, but in a combination lacking in harmony or charm. She had inherited her mother's small, beautiful eyes and her father's huge nose, or a smaller version of it, although not small enough to be excused. While this nose on her father's face, where it fit, lent his face a noticeable majesty, it added nothing to the girl's looks. Aisha was in her prime at 16. She was the very picture of beauty. She was of slender build and figure. But in her family circle, this was considered a defect, to be remedied by the ministrations of Hanafi. Her face was as beautiful as the moon. She had a white complexion suffused with rosy highlights, and her father's blue eyes, which went well with her mother's small nose. Unlike all the others, she had golden hair, inherently from her paternal grandmother, thanks to the laws of genetics. It was natural that Khadija should grasp the differences between her and her sister. Neither her extraordinary proficiency in running the house and doing embroidery, or her indefatigable vigor, which never dimmed or dulled, gained her anything. On the whole, Khadija felt a jealousy toward Aisha she did not bother to hide, thereby causing the beautiful girl to be upset with her frequently. Fortunately, this natural jealousy did not leave any negative residue deep in her soul. She was content to vent it through the sarcastic sauciness of her tongue. Moreover, she was a girl who, despite the handicaps nature had given her, had a heart full of affection for her family, even though she did not spare them her bitter mockery. Regardless of how long her jealousy lasted, it did not warp her disposition or become hatred or loathing. Although her sarcasm was humorous when aimed at a member of her family, she was a scold of the first degree with regard to their neighbors and acquaintances. Her eyes, like the needle of a compass always attracted to the magnetic pole, lit first on people's imperfections. If their shortcomings were cloaked, she contrived to uncover and enlarge them. Then she applied epithets to her victims to match their defects. They were usually known by these in the family circle. She called the widow of the late Mr. Shaukat, the oldest friend of her parents, the machine gun, because of the way her spittle flew when she talked. Maryam, their next-door neighbor, she named Could You Spare, because she borrowed household utensils from them now and then. The teacher at the Quran school of Palace Walk was the evilest of creation, because when he taught, he frequently recited this verse from the Quran, Surah 113, verse 2, along with the rest of the surah, and because of his ugly face. The cooked beans vendor was baldy, because he had no hair, the milkman, one eye, because his vision was impaired. The nicknames she gave the members of her family were less virulent. Her mother was the muezzin, because she rose so early, Fami, the bedpost, because he was slender, and Aisha, the reed, for the same reason. Yasin she called Bamba Kashar, after a notorious chanteuse of the day, since he was both plump and fastidious. Her outspokenness was not merely satirical. There was truly no limit to her harshness if someone got in her family's way. Then her criticism of people was violent and devoid of tolerance and forgiveness. She showed a pronounced lack of interest in the sorrows that troubled people from day to day. This harshness was displayed domestically in her unparalleled treatment of Hanafi, and even in her handling of the domestic animals, such as the cats, which were pampered by Aisha in ways beyond description. Her rudeness to Hanafi was a subject of controversy between her and her mother. The mother treated her servants exactly like part of her family. She thought everyone was an angel and did not know how to think ill of anyone. Khadija, on the other hand, was disposed to suspect the woman, since it was her nature to be suspicious of everyone. She did not hide her fear that the servant slept too close to the storeroom. She asked her mother,
"How did she get so fat? From the remedies she concocts? We all consume those, and we haven't gotten fat like her. It's the butter and honey she skims off without measure when we're asleep."
The mother defended Hanafi as best she could. When her daughter's insistence got on her nerves, she said,
"Let her eat what she wants. We have lots, and her belly has limits that cannot be exceeded. We'll not go hungry in any case."
Khadija was not pleased by this remark. She began to examine the tins of butter and jars of honey every morning. Hanafi observed this behavior with a smile. She loved the whole family for the sake of her excellent mistress. Khadija did not behave like this with members of her family. If one of them was indisposed, she was filled with tenderness and knew no rest. When Kemal came down with measles, she insisted on sharing his bed. She could not stand for even Aisha to be afflicted by the slightest misfortune. Her heart had no equal, both in coldness and in compassion. When she sat down to eat, she abandoned her quarrel with Aisha. She attacked the beans and eggs with an appetite that was proverbial in the family. For all of them, food, in addition to its nutritional value, ultimately served an aesthetic goal because it was the natural foundation for becoming well-rounded. They ate deliberately and painstakingly. They did their very best to chew their food thoroughly. They did not even slow down when they were full. They kept on eating until they were stuffed, each according to her capacity. The mother was the first to finish, followed by Aisha. Khadija was left alone with the remaining food. She did not quit until all the dishes were wiped clean. Aisha's slenderness did not correspond to the diligence with which she ate. The magic of the fattening potions failed on her. Khadija was moved to make fun of her, suggesting that evil machinations had caused her to be soil unfit for the good seed sowed in her. She also liked to ascribe Aisha's slenderness to the weakness of her faith. She would tell her,
"We all fast during Ramadan, except you. You pretend to fast, and then slip into the storeroom like a moose to fill your tummy with walnuts, almonds, and hazelnuts. Then you break your fast with us so ravenously that those who have been fasting envy your appetite, but God won't bless you."
The breakfast hour was one of the rare times when the three women were alone. Thus it was the most appropriate occasion for them to disclose and air secrets, especially about matters they would be embarrassed to discuss when the men of the family were present. Khadija had something she wanted to say, even though she was busy eating. She remarked in a calm voice, totally different from the yell she had recently employed,
"Mother, I had a strange dream."
In deference to her intimidating daughter, the mother replied, even before she swallowed the morsel in her mouth,
"A good dream, daughter, God willing."
Khadija said with increased concern,
"I seem to be walking on the wall of a roof terrace. Perhaps it was the roof of our house or another. Then an unknown person pushed me off, and I felt screaming."
Aisha's interest was serious enough to cause her to stop eating, but her sister was silent for a short time to create the greatest possible impression. Their mother murmured,
"God grant it's for the best."
Trying not to smile, Aisha asked,
"Wasn't I the unknown person who pushed you? Isn't that so?"
Khadija was afraid the mood would be ruined by this joke. She shouted at her,
"It's a dream, not a game. Stop your foolishness."
Then, addressing her mother, she said,
"I fell screaming, but I didn't hit the ground as I expected. Instead, I landed on a horse that carried me off and flew away."
Amina sighed with relief as though she had grasped the meaning of the dream and was reassured by it. She smiled and resumed eating. Then she said,
"Who knows, Khadija? Perhaps it's your bridegroom."
Talking about the bridegroom was permitted only on an occasion like this, and then only in the form of a terse allusion. The girl's heart throbbed. She was apprehensive about marriage in a way she was about nothing else. She believed in her dream and the interpretation. Therefore, she was overjoyed by her mother's words. All the same, she wanted to disguise her embarrassment with irony, as usual, even if it was at her own expense, and said,
"You think the horse is a bridegroom? My bridegroom will have to be an ass."
Aisha laughed till bits of food flew from her mouth. Fearing Khadija would misinterpret her laughter, she said,
"You put yourself down too much, Khadija. You're just fine."
Khadija cast a glance full of suspicion and doubt. Then their mother started to speak.
"You're an extraordinary girl. Who can match your skill or energy, or your quick wit and pretty face? What more can you ask for?"
The girl touched the tip of her nose with her finger and asked with a laugh,
"Doesn't this stand in the way of marriage?"
Smiling, her mother replied,
"Nonsense. You're still young, daughter."
Khadija was distressed to have youth mentioned, since she did not consider herself young compared with the age most girls were when they married. She said to her mother,
"You married, mother, before you turned 14.
The mother, who was actually no less apprehensive than her daughter, replied,
"Nothing comes early or late, except as God grants."
Aisha sincerely wished,
"May our Lord soon allow us to celebrate your wedding."
Khadija looked at her skeptically, remembering how one of the neighbor women had asked to marry Aisha to her son. Their father had refused to let the younger sister marry before the elder. She asked,
"Do you really want me to marry? Or do you hope it will leave the way clear for you to marry?"
Aisha answered with a laugh,
"Both."
6. When they had finished breakfast, the mother said,
"Aisha, you do the laundry today, and Khadija will clean the house. Afterward, meet me in the oven room."
Amina divided the work between them right after breakfast. They were content to be ruled by her, and Aisha would not question her assignment. Khadija would take the trouble to make a few comments, either to show her worth or to start a quarrel. Thus, she said,
"I'll let you clean the house if you think washing the clothes is too much. But if you make a fuss over the washing so you can stay in the bathroom till all the work in the kitchen is finished, that's an excuse that can be rejected in advance."
Aisha ignored her remark and went off to the bath humming. Khadija commented sarcastically,
"Lucky for you, that sound reverberates in the bathroom like a phonograph speaker. So sing, and let the neighbors hear it."
Their mother left the room and went through the hall to the stairs. She climbed to the roof to make her morning rounds there, before descending to the oven room. The bickering between her daughters was nothing new to her. Over the course of time, it had turned into a customary way of life when the father was not at home, and no one could think of anything pleasant to say. She had tried to stop it by using entreaty, humor, and tenderness. That was the only type of discipline she employed with her children. It fit her nature, which could not stand anything stronger. She lacked the firmness that rearing children occasionally requires. Perhaps she would have liked to be firm, but was not able to. Perhaps she had attempted to be firm, but had been overcome by her emotions and weakness. It seemed she could not bear for the ties between her and her children to be anything but love and affection. She let the father, or his shadow, which dominated the children from afar, straighten them out and lay down the law. Thus, their silly quarrel did not weaken her admiration for her two girls, or her satisfaction with them. Even Aisha, who was insanely fond of singing, and standing in front of the mirror, her laziness notwithstanding, was no less skillful and organized than Khadija. Amina would have been justified in allowing herself long periods of relaxation, but she was prevented by a natural tendency that was almost a disease. She insisted on supervising everything in the house, no matter how small. When the girls finished their work, she would go around energetically inspecting the rooms, living areas, and halls with a broom in one hand and a feather duster in the other. She searched the corners, walls, curtains, and all the furnishings to eliminate an overlooked speck of dust, finding as much pleasure and satisfaction in that as in removing a speck from her eye. She was by nature such a perfectionist that she examined the clothes about to be laundered. If she discovered a piece of clothing that was unusually dirty, she would not spare the owner a gentle reminder of his duty, whether it was Kamal, who was going on 10, or Yasin, who had two clear and contradictory approaches to caring for himself. He was excessively fastidious about his external appearance, his suit, fez, shirt, necktie, and shoes, but shockingly neglectful of his underwear. Naturally, this comprehensive concern of hers did not exclude the roof and the pigeons and chickens that inhabited it. In fact, the time she spent on the roof was filled with love and delight from the opportunities it presented for work, not to mention the joys of play and merriment she found there. No wonder, for the roof was a new world she had discovered. The big house had known nothing of it until she joined the family. She had created it afresh through the force of her spirit, back when the house retained the appearance it had always had since being built ages before. It was her idea to have these cages with the cooing pigeons put on some of the high walls. She had arranged these wooden chicken coops where the hens clucked as they foraged for food. How much joy she got from scattering grain for them, or putting the water container on the ground as the hens raced for it, preceded by their rooster. Their beaks fell on the grain quickly and regularly, like sewing machine needles, leaving little indentations in the dust, like the pockmarks from a drizzle. How good she felt when she saw them gazing at her with clear little eyes, inquisitive and questioning, while they cackled and clucked with a shared affection that filled her heart with tenderness. She loved the chickens and pigeons as she loved all of God's creatures. She made little noises to them, thinking they understood and responded. Her imagination had bestowed conscious, intelligent life on all animals, and occasionally even on inanimate objects. She was quite certain that these beings praised her Lord and were in contact, by various means, with the spirit world. Her world, with its earth and sky, animals and plants, was a living, intelligent one. Its merits were not confined to the blessing of life. It found its completion in worship. It was not strange, then, that relying on one excuse or another, she prolonged the lives of the roosters and hens. One hen was full of life, another a good layer. This rooster woke her in the morning with his crowing. Perhaps if it had been left entirely to her, she would never have consented to put her knife to their throats. If circumstances did force her to slaughter one, she selected a chicken or pigeon with a feeling close to anguish. She would give it a drink, seek God's mercy for it, invoke God's name, ask forgiveness, and then slaughter it. Her consolation was that she was exercising a right that God the Benefactor had granted to all those who serve Him. The most amazing aspect of the roof was the southern half overlooking En-Nehessin Street. There, in years past, she had planted a special garden. There was not another one like it in the whole neighborhood on any of the other roofs, which were usually covered with chicken droppings. She had first begun with a small number of pots of carnations and roses. They had increased year by year and were arranged in rows parallel to the sides of the walls. They grew splendidly, and she had the idea of putting a trellis over the top. She got a carpenter to install it. Then she planted both jasmine and hyacinth bean vines. She attached them to the trellis and around the posts. They grew tall and spread out until the area was transformed into an arbor garden with a green sky from which jasmine flowed down. An enchanting, sweet fragrance was diffused throughout. This roof, with its inhabitants of chickens and pigeons, and its arbor garden, was her beautiful, beloved world, and her favorite place for relaxation out of the whole universe, about which she knew nothing. As usual at this hour, she set about caring for it. She swept it, watered the plants, fed the chickens and pigeons. Then, for a long time, with smiling lips and dreamy eyes, she enjoyed the scene around her. She went to the end of the garden and stood behind the interwoven coiling vines to gaze out through the openings at the limitless space around her. She was awed by the minarets which shot up, making a profound impression on her. Some were near enough for her to see their lamps and crescent distinctly, like those of Kalaun in Barkuk. Others appeared to her as complete holes, lacking details, like the minarets of the mosques of Al-Hussein, Al-Huri, and Al-Azhar. Still other minarets were at the far horizon and seemed phantoms, like those of the Citadel and Rifai mosques. She turned her face toward them with devotion, fascination, thanksgiving, and hope. Her spirit soared over their tops, as close as possible to the heavens. Then her eyes would fix on the minaret of the mosque of Al-Hussein, the dearest one to her because of her love for its namesake. She looked at it affectionately, and her yearnings mingled with the sorrow that pervaded her every time she remembered she was not allowed to visit the son of the prophet of God's daughter, even though she lived only minutes away from his shrine. She sighed audibly, and that broke the spell. She began to amuse herself by looking at the roofs and streets. The yearnings would not leave her. She turned her back on the wall. Looking at the unknown had overwhelmed her, both what is unknown to most people, the invisible spirit world, and the unknown with respect to her in particular, Cairo, even the adjacent neighborhood from which voices reached her. What could this world of which she saw nothing but the minarets and roofs be like? A quarter of a century had passed while she was confined to this house, leaving it only on infrequent occasions to visit her mother in Al-Khurunfush. Her husband escorted her on each visit in a carriage because he could not bear for anyone to see his wife, either alone or accompanied by him. She was neither resentful nor discontented, quite the opposite. All the same, when she peeked through the openings between the jasmine and the hyacinth bean vines, off into space, at the minarets and rooftops, her delicate lips would rise in a tender, dreamy smile. Where might the law school be where Fami was sitting at this moment? Where was the Khalil Agha school, which Kamal assured her was only a minute's trip from the mosque of El Hussein? Before leaving the roof, she spread her hands out in prayer and called on her Lord.
God, I ask you to watch over my husband and children, my mother and Yasin, and all the people, Muslims and Christians, even the English, my Lord, but drive them from our land as a favor to Fami, who does not like them.
7. When El Sayyid Ahmed Abdel Jawad reached his store, situated in front of the Mosque of Barkuk on En-Nehessin Street, his assistant, Jamil El Hamzawi, had already opened and readied it for their customers. The proprietor greeted him courteously and, smiling sweetly, headed for his desk. El Hamzawi was 50. He had spent 30 of these years in the shop as an assistant to the founder, El Hajj Abdel Jawad, and then to El Sayyid Ahmed after the father's death. He remained loyal to his master both for the sake of his job and out of devotion. He revered and loved him the way everyone did who had any dealings with him, whether of business or friendship. The truth was that he was dreaded and feared only in his own family. With everyone else, friends, acquaintances, and customers, he was a different person. He received his share of respect and esteem, but above all else, was loved. He was loved for the charm of his personality more than for any of his many other fine characteristics. His acquaintances did not know what he was like at home. The members of his family did not know him as others did. His store was of medium size. Containers of coffee beans, rice, nuts, dried fruit, and soap were crammed on the shelves and piled by the walls. The owner's desk, with its ledgers, papers, and telephone, stood on the left, opposite the entrance. To the right of where he sat, there was a green safe mounted to the wall. It looked reassuringly solid, and its color was reminiscent of banknotes. In the center of the wall over the desk hung an ebony frame containing an Arabic inscription illuminated in gold that read, "In the name of God." Business was light early in the morning. The proprietor began to review the accounts of the previous day with a zeal inherited from his father, but preserved with his own abundant vitality. Meanwhile, El Hamzawi stood by the entrance, his arms folded against his chest. He was reciting to himself the Quran verses he knew best. His voice could not be heard, but the continual motion of his lips gave him away. From time to time, a faint whisper slipped out from a sibilant S sound. He continued his recitation upon the arrival of the blind sheikh, who had been retained to recite the Quran every morning. El Sayyid Ahmed would raise his head from his ledger every so often to listen to the recitation, or look out at the street at the endless flow of passers-by, hand and horse carts, and Suarez omnibus, which was so big and heavy it could scarcely wobble along. There were singing vendors who chanted jingles about their tomatoes, mallow greens, and okra, each in his own style. The commotion did not interfere with the proprietor's concentration. He had grown accustomed to it over a period of more than 30 years. He was so lulled by the noise that he was disturbed if it ceased. A customer came in, and Al-Hamzawi waited on him. Some friends and neighbors who were merchants stopped by. They liked to visit with Al-Sayyid Ahmed, even if only for a short time. They would exchange greetings and enjoy one of his pleasantries or witty sayings. They made him feel proud of his skill as a gifted storyteller. His conversation had brilliant touches relating to the popular culture that he had absorbed not from schooling, since he had never finished primary school, but from reading newspapers and befriending an elite group of gentry, government officials, and attorneys. His native wit, graciousness, charm, and status as a prosperous merchant qualified him to associate with them on an equal footing. He had molded a mentality for himself different from the limited mercantile one. The love, respect, and honor these fine people bestowed on him doubled his pride. When one of them sincerely and truthfully told him,
"If you had had the opportunity to study law, you would have been an exceptionally eloquent attorney,"
this statement inflated his ego. All the same, he was good at hiding his pride with his charm, modesty, and affability. None of these visitors stayed long. They went off one after the other, and the pace of work increased in the shop. All at once a man rushed in as though propelled by a powerful hand. He stood in the middle of the store, squinting his narrow eyes to see better. He aimed them at the owner's desk. Although he was no more than 3 meters away, his efforts to make him out were to no avail. So he called out,
"Is Al-Sayyid Ahmed Abdel Jabbar here?"
The proprietor replied with a smile,
"Welcome, Sheikh Mutawali Abdel Samad. Have a seat. You bless us with your presence."
The man bent his head. It so happened that as Al-Hamzawi approached to greet him, the visitor, who did not notice his outstretched hand, sneezed unexpectedly. Al-Hamzawi drew back and took out his handkerchief. A smile and a frown collided on his face. The sheikh plunged toward the desk, muttering,
"Praise God, Lord of the universe."
He raised the edge of his cloak and wiped his face with it. He sat down on the chair his host offered him. The sheikh appeared to be in enviable health for his age, which was over 75. If it had not been for his weak eyes, his eyelids that were inflamed at the edges, and his sunken mouth, he would have had nothing to complain of. He was wrapped in a faded, threadbare cloak. Although he could have exchanged it for a better one through the donations of benefactors, he clung to it. He said that Al-Hussein had blessed him in a dream, and thus had given the cloak he wore an excellence that would not fade away. The sheikh had performed miracles by penetrating the barriers of normal human knowledge to the invisible realm. He was known equally for his healing prayers, amulets, candor, and wit. He was at home with humor and mirth, and that especially endeared him to Al-Sayyid Ahmed. Although a resident of the quarter, he did not burden any of his disciples with his visits. Months might pass without anyone knowing where he was. When he dropped by after an absence, he received a warm welcome and presents. The owner gestured to his assistant to prepare the usual present of rice, coffee, and soap for the sheikh. Then he said, to welcome him,
"We've missed you, Sheikh Mutawali. We haven't had the pleasure of seeing you since the holiday of Ashura."
The man replied bluntly,
"I'm absent when I think fit, and present when I choose. You should not ask why."
The proprietor, who was used to his style, stammered,
"Even when you are absent, your blessing is present."
The sheikh did not seem touched by this praise. On the contrary, he shook his head in a way that showed his patience was exhausted. He said gruffly,
"Haven't I warned you more than once not to speak to me until I address you? You should be silent."
Feeling an urge to vex him, the proprietor said,
"Sorry, Sheikh Abdel Samad. I forgot your warning. My excuse is that I forgot it because you have been absent so long."
The sheikh struck his hands together and shouted,
"An excuse is worse than a sin."
Pointing his index finger in a threatening way, he continued,
"If you persist in disobeying me, I'll be unable to accept your gift."
The proprietor sealed his lips and spread out his hands in submission, constraining himself to be quiet this time. Sheikh Mutawali waited to be sure of his obedience. After clearing his throat, he said,
I commence with a prayer in honor of Muhammad, the beloved master of creation.
The proprietor responded from his depth,
God's blessing and peace on him.
I praise your father as he deserves. May God have plentiful compassion for him and grant him a spacious abode in his paradise. I can almost see him sitting where you are. The difference between the two of you being that your late father retained the turban, and you have traded it in for this fez.
The proprietor murmured with a smile,
May God forgive us.
The sheikh yawned till tears came to his eyes. Then he spoke again.
I pray to God that he may grant your children prosperity and piety. Yasin, Khadija, Fami, Aisha, and Kemal and their mother. Amen.
Hearing the sheikh pronounce the names Khadija and Aisha sounded odd to Al-Said Ahmed, even though he was the one who had told him their names a long time ago, so he could write amulet inscriptions for them. It was not the first time the sheikh had pronounced their names, nor would it be the last, but never would the name of any of his women be mentioned outside their chambers, even on the tongue of the Sheikh Mutawali, without its having a strange and unpleasant impact on him, even if only for a short time. All the same, he muttered,
Amen, O Lord of the universe.
The sheikh said with a sigh,
Then I ask God the benefactor to return to us our leader Abbas, backed by one of the caliph's armies, which are without beginning or end.
We so ask him, and it would not be difficult for him.
The sheikh's voice rose as he said angrily,
And that he afflict the English and their allies with a shocking defeat, leaving them without a leg to stand on.
May our Lord carry them all off.
The sheikh shook his head sorrowfully. He said with anguish,
Yesterday, I was walking in the mosque when two Australian soldiers blocked my way. They told me to hand over everything I had. So I emptied my pockets for them and brought out the one thing I had, an ear of corn. One of them took it and kicked it like a ball. The other snatched my turban. He unwound the cloth from it, ripped it, and flung it in my face.
The proprietor listened closely, fighting off the temptation to smile. He quickly disguised it by an exaggerated display of disapproval. He shouted in condemnation,
May God destroy and annihilate them!
The other man concluded his account.
I raised my hand to the sky and called out, Almighty God, rip their nation to shreds, the way they ripped my turban cloth.
Your prayer will be answered, God willing.
The sheikh leaned back and closed his eyes to rest a little. Meanwhile, the proprietor scrutinized his face and smiled. Then the religious guide opened his eyes and addressed him in a calm voice and a new tone, giving warning of a new subject. He said,
What an astute and gallant man you are, Ahmed, you son of Abdul Jabbar.
The proprietor smiled with pleasure. He responded in a low voice,
I ask God's forgiveness, Sheikh Abdul Samad.
The sheikh interrupted him, saying,
Not so fast. I'm the sort of person who praises only to clear the way to speak the truth, for the sake of encouragement, son of Abdul Jabbar.
A wary circumspection was evident in the eyes of the proprietor. He muttered,
May our Lord be gracious to us.
The sheikh gestured at him with his gnarled forefinger and asked him threateningly,
What do you have to say as a devout Muslim concerning your lust for women?
The proprietor was accustomed to his candor. Thus he was not troubled by his assault. After a brief laugh, he replied,
How can you fault me for that? Didn't the messenger of God, the blessing and peace of God upon him, speak of his love for perfume and women?
The sheikh frowned and looked even grimmer in protest against the proprietor's logic, which he did not like. He countered,
"Licit acts are not the same as forbidden ones. You, son of Abdel Jabbat, marriage is not the same as chasing after hussies."
The proprietor stared at nothing in particular and said in a serious tone,
"I have never allowed myself to offend against honor or dignity at all. Praise God for that."
The sheikh struck his hands on his knees and exclaimed with astonishment and disgust,
"A weak excuse fit only for a weak person. Immorality is damnable, even if it is with a debauched woman. Your father, may God have mercy on him, was crazy about women. He married 20 times. Why don't you follow his path and shun the sinners?"
The proprietor laughed out loud. He asked,
"Are you one of God's saints or a nuptial official? My father was almost sterile, so he married many times. Even though I was his only child, his property was split up between me and his last four wives, not to mention what he lost during his lifetime in divorce settlements. Now I'm the father of three males and two females. It wouldn't be proper for me to slip into more marriages and have to divide the wealth that God has bestowed on us. Don't forget, Sheikh Mutawali, that the professional women entertainers of today are the slave girls of yesterday, whose purchase and sale God made legal. More than anything else, God is forgiving and merciful."
The sheikh moaned. Shaking his torso right and left, he said,
"How adept you are, you sons of Adam, in embellishing evil. By God, you son of Abdel Jabbat, were it not for my love of you, I would not suffer you to speak to me, you fornicator."
The proprietor spread out his hands and said with a smile,
"God grant."
The sheikh snorted in annoyance and yelled,
"If it weren't for your jokes, you'd be the most perfect of men."
"Perfection is God's alone."
The sheikh turned toward him and motioned with his hand as if to say,
"Let's put this aside."
Then he asked in the tone of an interrogator tightening his grip around his victim's throat,
"And wine? What do you say about that?"
Suddenly the proprietor's spirits flagged. His discomfort was apparent in his eyes. He remained silent for some time. The sheikh sensed submission in his silence. He shouted in triumph,
"Isn't it forbidden? No one would succumb to it who strives to obey and love God."
The proprietor interrupted with the zeal of a man fending off a veritable disaster.
"I certainly strive to obey and love him."
"By the word or deed?"
Although he had an answer ready, he took some time to think about it before replying. He was not accustomed to busying himself with introspection or self-analysis. In this way, he was like most people who are rarely alone. His mind did not swing into action until some external force required it, a man or woman or some element of his material life. He had surrendered himself to the busy current of his life, submerging himself totally in it. All he saw of himself was his reflection on the surface of the stream. Moreover, his zest for life had not diminished as he grew older. He was 45, and still enjoyed an ardent and exuberant vigor like that of an adolescent youth. His life was composed of a diversity of mutually contradictory elements, wavering between piety and depravity. Contradictory though they were, they all met with his satisfaction, without needing to be propped up by any pillar of personal philosophy or hypocritical rationalization. His conduct issued directly from his special nature. Having a clear conscience, he was good-hearted and sincere in everything he did. His breast was not shaken by storms of doubt, and he passed his nights peacefully. His faith was deep. It was true that he had inherited it, and that there was no room for innovation in it. All the same, his sensitivity, discernment, and sincerity had added an elevated, refined feeling to it, which prevented it from being a blind traditionalism, or a ritualism inspired by nothing but desire or fear. The most striking characteristic of his faith as a whole was its pure, fertile love. Using it, he set about performing all his duties to God, like prayer, fasting, or almsgiving, with love, ease, and happiness, not to mention a clear conscience, a heart abounding in love for people, and a soul that was generous in its gallantry and help for others. These qualities made him a dear friend. People vied to enjoy the pleasures of his friendship. With the same ardent, overflowing vitality, he opened his breast to the joys and pleasures of life. He delighted in fancy food. He was enchanted by vintage wine. He was crazy about a pretty face. He pursued each of these pleasures with gaiety, joy, and passion. His conscience was not weighed down by guilty feelings or anxious scruples. He was exercising a right granted him by life, as though there was no conflict between the duty life gave his heart and the duty God entrusted to his conscience. At no time in his life had he felt estranged from God or a target for his vengeance. He communed peacefully with him. Was he two separate people combined into one personality? Was his faith in the divine magnanimity so strong that he could not believe these pleasures really had been forbidden? Even if they were forbidden, should they not be excused so long as no one was harmed? Most probably what happened was that he embraced life with his heart and emotions without resorting to thought or reflection. He found within himself strong instincts, some directed toward God and tamed through worship, and others set for pleasure and quenched in play. The integration of all these within him was secure and carefree. His soul was not disturbed by any need to reconcile them. He was not forced to justify them in his thoughts, except under the pressure of criticism like that with which Sheikh Mutawali Abdul Samad confronted him. Under such circumstances, he found himself more distressed by thinking than by the accusation itself, not because he shrugged off being accused before God, but because he could not believe that he was actually being accused, or that God would truly be angry at him for having a little fun that harmed no one. Thought, however, was a burden and revealed how trivial his knowledge of his religion was. For this reason, he frowned when the other man challengingly asked him whether his obedience was by word or deed. He responded in a tone that did not hide his distress.
By word and deed both, by prayer, fasting, and almsgiving, by remembering God whether I am standing or sitting. Why is it wrong for me, after that, to refresh myself with a little fun, harming no one, or for me to overlook one rule? Is nothing forbidden save these two things?
The Sheikh raised his eyebrows and closed his eyes to indicate that he did not agree. Then he muttered,
"What a perverse defense!"
The proprietor suddenly went from anxiety to gaiety, as was his wont, and said expansively,
"God is clement and merciful, Sheikh Abdul Al-Samad. I don't picture him, may he be high and exalted, being in any way spiteful or sullen. Even his vengeance is mercy in disguise. I offer him love, obedience, reverence, and a good deed is worth 10.
In the calculus of good deeds, you have the most to gain."
The proprietor motioned to Jamil Al-Hamzawi to bring the Sheikh's present. He said happily,
"God's all we need, along with the favors of his deputy."
The proprietor's assistant brought him the parcel, which he took and presented to the Sheikh.
"To your health,"
he said with a laugh. The Sheikh accepted it and said,
"May God provide for you generously and forgive you."
The proprietor mumbled,
"Amen."
Then smiling, he asked him,
"Weren't you well off once, master?"
The Sheikh laughed and replied,
"May God go easy on you. You're a generous man with a good heart. I take this occasion to caution you against excessive generosity, for it is not compatible with making a living as a merchant."
The proprietor asked in astonishment,
"Are you tempting me to withdraw the gift?"
The man rose and replied,
"The gift to me is not excessive. Begin somewhere else, you son of Abdul Jawad. Peace to you and God's mercy."
The Sheikh left the store in a hurry and disappeared from sight. The proprietor kept on thinking. He was mulling over the dispute that had flared up between him and the sheikh. Then he spread his hands out in entreaty. He mumbled,
God, forgive me both my bygone and recent sins. God, you are clement and merciful.
8. Kemal left the Khalil Agha school in the afternoon, bobbing along in the swelling current of pupils who blocked off the road with their flow. They began to scatter, some along Ed-Darasa, some on New Street, others on El Hussein. Meanwhile, bands of them encircled the roving vendors stationed to catch them at the ends of the streets that branched out from the school. Their baskets contained melon seeds, peanuts, doom palm fruit, and sweets. At this hour, the street also witnessed fights, which broke out here and there between pupils forced to keep their disagreements quiet during the day to avoid school punishment. Kemal had only rarely been embroiled in a fight, perhaps not more than twice during the 2 years he had been at the school. He had avoided fights, not from a lack of disputes, which actually were plentiful, nor because he disliked fighting. Being forced to renounce fighting caused him profound regret, but the overwhelming majority of the other pupils were much older, making him and a few of his companions aliens in the school. They stumbled along in their short pants, surrounded by pupils over 15, many close to 20. They plowed through the younger boys pompously and haughtily, sporting their mustaches. One of them would stop him in the school courtyard for no reason and snatch the book from his hand to toss far away like a ball. Another would take a piece of candy from him and pop it in his own mouth, without so much as asking, while carrying on a conversation with someone else. Kemal's desire to fight did not desert him, but he suppressed it out of fear of the consequences. He responded only when one of his young companions provoked him. He found that attacking them vented his stifled rebellious feelings. It was a way to regain confidence in himself and his strength. Neither fighting nor being forced to refrain was the worst insult the aggressors could inflict. There were the curses and bad language that reached his ears, whether or not intended for him. He understood the meaning of some of the expressions and was cautious with them. Others he did not know and repeated innocently at home, thus stirring up a storm of outrage and indignation. This led to a complaint to the school disciplinarian, who was a friend of his father's. It was nothing but bad luck which decreed that his adversary in one of his two fights was from a family of known toughs living in Ed-Darasa. On the afternoon following the battle, Kemal found waiting for him at the door of the school a gang of youths, armed with sticks, forming a ring of terrifying evil. When his adversary gestured to point him out, Kemal grasped the danger lying in wait for him. He fled back to the school and appealed to the disciplinary officer for help. The man tried in vain to dissuade the gang from its objective. They spoke so rudely to him that he was forced to summon a policeman to escort the boy home. The disciplinarian paid a call on Kemal's father at his shop and told him of the danger menacing his son. He advised him to attempt to resolve the matter prudently and diplomatically. His father had recourse to some merchants he knew in Ed-Darasa. They went to the home of the toughs to intercede for him. Thus the father made use of his well-known forbearance and sensitivity to soothe their tempers. They not only forgave the boy, but swore to protect him like one of their sons. The day was not over before El Sayyid Ahmed sent someone to them with several presents. Kemal escaped from the sticks of the toughs, but it was like jumping out of the pan into the fire. His father's stick did more to his feet than tens of others would have. Kemal started home from school. Although the sound of the bell signaling the end of the school day brought a joy to his soul, unmatched by any other in those days, still the breeze of freedom he inhaled lightheartedly outside the school gates did not obliterate from his mind the echoes of the last class, which was also his favorite, religion. That day the sheikh had recited to them the Quran surah containing, "Say it is revealed unto me that a group of the jinn listened." Surah 72, verse 1. Kemal had concentrated his attention on it, and raised his hand more than once to ask about points he did not understand. Since the teacher was favorably disposed toward him on account of the extraordinary interest he displayed in the lesson, as well as his excellent memorization of Quran surahs, he was much more open to the boy's questions than he usually was with his pupils. The sheikh had undertaken to tell him about the jinn and their different groups, including the Muslim jinn, and in particular the jinn who will gain entry to paradise in the end as an example for their brothers, the human beings. The boy learned by heart every word he said. He kept on turning the lesson around in his mind until he crossed the street to get to the pastry shop. In addition to his enthusiasm for religious studies, he knew he was not just learning it for himself alone. He would have to repeat what he had grasped to his mother at home, as he had been doing since he was in Quranic kindergarten. He would tell her about the lesson, and she would review, in the light of this new information, what she had previously learned from her father, a religious scholar trained at Al-Azhar Mosque University. They would discuss what they knew for a long time. Then he would teach her the new Quran surahs she had not previously memorized. He reached the pastry shop and stretched out his hand with the small change he had hung on to since morning. He took a piece of pastry with a total delight he experienced only on such a sweet occasion. It made him frequently dream of owning a candy store one day, not to sell the candy, but to eat it. He continued on his way down Al Hussein Street, munching on the pastry with pleasure. He hummed and forgot he had been a prisoner all day long, not allowed to move, not to mention play or have fun. He was a sitting duck to be struck at any moment by the teacher's stick raised threateningly over the pupils' heads. In spite of all this, he did not hate school totally, since his accomplishments within its walls brought him praise and encouragement. His brother Fahmi was impressed because he did so well. But Kemal did not even receive 1% of his brother's appreciation from his father. On his way, he passed by the tobacco store of Matusian. He stopped under its sign, as he did every day at this hour, and raised his small eyes to the colored poster of a woman reclining on a divan with a cigarette between her crimson lips, from which rose a curling plume of smoke. She was leaning her arm on the windowsill. The curtain was drawn back to reveal a scene combining a grove of date palms and a branch of the Nile. He privately called the woman Aisha after his sister, since they both had golden hair and blue eyes. Although he was just going on 10, his admiration for the mistress of the poster was limitless. How often he thought of her enjoying life in its most splendid manifestations. How often he imagined himself sharing her carefree days in that luxurious room with its pristine view that offered her, in fact both of them, its earth, palms, water, and sky. He would swim in the green river valley, or cross the water in the skiff that appeared ghost-like far off in the picture. He would shake the palm trees till the dates fell around him, or sit near the beautiful woman, with his eyes gazing at her dreamy ones. He was not good-looking like his brothers. He was perhaps the one in the family who most resembled his sister Khadija. Like hers, his face combined his mother's small eyes and his father's huge nose, but without the refinement of Khadija's. He had a large head, with a forehead that protruded noticeably, making his eyes seem even more sunken than they actually were. Unfortunately, he had first realized how strange he looked when a schoolmate teased him and called him a two-headed boy. Kemal had been enraged, and his anger had gotten him into one of his two fights. Even after he taught the boy a lesson, he was still upset and complained of his unhappiness to his mother. She was upset because he was. She tried to console him, telling him that people with large heads had large brains, and that the Prophet, peace be upon him, had a large head. To resemble the Prophet was the ultimate that anyone could aspire to. He tore himself away from the picture of the smoking lady, and gazed this time at the mosque of Al-Hussein. He had been taught to revere Al-Hussein, and not surprisingly the holy martyr's shrine provided his imagination with countless sensations. Although his high regard for Al-Hussein, matching the high status his mother in particular and the family in general accorded him, derived from Al-Hussein's relationship to his grandfather, the Prophet, Kemal's knowledge of the Prophet had not provided him with what he knew about Al-Hussein, and the events of his life. Nor did it explain the way his soul always hungered to have the saga of Al-Hussein repeated, so he could draw from it the finest stories and the deepest faith. This centuries-old saga had found in Kemal an attentive, passionate, loving, believing, grieving, weeping listener. His suffering response was eased only by the fact that the martyr's head, after being severed from his immaculate body, chose Egypt from all the world for its resting place. Immaculate, it came to Cairo, glorifying God, and settled to the ground where Al-Hussein's shrine now stands. Kemal frequently stood in front of the shrine, dreaming and thinking. He wished his vision could penetrate it to see the beautiful face. His mother had assured him it had withstood the vicissitudes of time because of its divine secret being. It had preserved its bloom and beauty, so that it lit up the darkness of its abode. Although unable to fulfill his wish, he stood there for long periods, communing with himself. He expressed his love and told his problems to the Prophet's grandson. These arose from his vivid daydreams about the jinn and his father's threats. He would implore Al-Hussein's assistance for his exams, which he had to take every 3 months. He would usually conclude his private audience with a plea for a visit in his dreams. His custom of passing by the mosque, both morning and evening, had somewhat lessened its impact on him, but the moment his eyes fell on the shrine, he would repeat the opening prayer of the Quran, even if he passed by repeatedly in a single day. Indeed, the shrine's familiarity could not rob his breast of his splendid dreams. The sight of the towering wall still evoked a response from his heart, and the lofty minaret still called out to his soul.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.